luxury, a day of pomp and ceremony, a day of royalty.
But today we meet on another anniversary, the 300th of the founding of this illustrious college.
It was a day to remember the rich history and tradition of one of America's oldest and finest institutions of higher learning. WVEC and 13 News salute.
At this hour, the president talks of fairness as he asks the American people to swallow higher taxes in return for a long-term healthier economy. Republicans waste no time blasting the president's proposals, while most Americans, at least according to our polls, seem to approve of what the president talked about last night. And in Hollywood, a drought for leading ladies. Also coming up in this half hour, the weather and the sports. We'll hear how last night's presidential address played with three of our own correspondents here at ABC News. And we'll see how the front pages of newspapers around the country treated the president's message as well. And it is a fascinating mix in the newspapers. All of that coming up in this half hour. Here we go. Congress and the American people have been bracing for it all week. It has been the dominant story of the week. And last night, President Clinton delivered the tough news, his $500 billion economic package. It includes raising the top income tax rate for families making at least $180,000 a year from 31%, where it is now, to 36%. Families earning at least $250,000 would see a 10% surtax on top of that. Those families making less than $30,000 a year will see no increase in their income tax, and there'll be a tax credit for the higher energy taxes that everyone is going to pay if the president's plan would pass. That's for under $30,000. For corporations making $10 million a year, the tax rate on corporations jumps from 34% to 36%, and the cost of business meals and entertainment, that deduction will be lowered from 80% to 50%. President Clinton added a warning about the future if Congress doesn't adopt his deficit reduction package.
I feel so strongly about this. All of our efforts to strengthen the economy will fail unless we also take this year, not next year, not 5 years from now, but this year, bold steps to reform our health care system.
The reaction on Capitol Hill to the president's speech was pretty much as you would expect along party lines. Congressman Dan Rostenkowski, the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, says that nobody likes to raise taxes, but there's a deficit that is out of control. The Senate Minority Leader, Robert Dole, the Republican, promised a spirited debate and warned that there's a long way to go before any tax hikes or spending reductions are passed by Congress. While many others on Capitol Hill reported that there was a pre-speech flood of negative phone calls on the president's proposal, that hasn't not been reflected in the post-speech poll that ABC News took. An ABC News Washington Post survey found an overwhelming majority of Americans approve of the Clinton plan, and a slightly larger majority said they believe they were being asked to shoulder a fair burden. But numbers are never as telling as words, and that's why we asked people of Hyde Park, New York, in this case, how they felt about what the president had to say.
I was optimistic, first of all, because I felt that he really laid out a program that, if followed, will work. And I was impressed by what he said at the end about we have to buy the whole piece.
I think the energy tax is a good idea. It hurts everybody, but it's probably as fair as you can get.
Good that the president has the courage to ask everyone to pull together.
Congress, the Senate, everyone has to back the president. We needed the president to take the bull by the horns and tackle the issues.
People of Hyde Park, New York, President Clinton and his cabinet leave Washington behind today to sell the economic plan directly to the people it will affect most. The president will be traveling to Missouri and Ohio, and on Friday he'll go to Hyde Park, New York, where those folks came from, and so did Franklin Roosevelt. Big news from Hollywood yesterday was the Oscar nominations, and it looks like it could be a very good year for Al Pacino, Clint Eastwood, and an unknown by the name of Neil Jordan, who produced, wrote, and directed The Crying Game. It was not, as it turns out, a very good year for women. Here's ABC's Judy Muller.
When Emma Thompson accepted the Golden Globe Award last month for Best Actress, she made a wish.
If I have a wish left in the world, it is just for the creation of more great female roles for us to enjoy playing.
She's not alone. Actresses have complained for some time about a shortage of roles with substance and depth. This year's Oscar nominees especially reflect that frustration. Along with Thompson, nominated for her role in Howard's End, are Susan Sarandon in Lorenzo's Oil, Michelle Pfeiffer in Love Field, Mary McDonnell in Passion Fish, and Catherine Deneuve in Indochine. While applauding those performances, critics say they are the best of a weak field.
Well, they clearly are reaching. I mean, they had to reach to France for Catherine Deneuve's nomination. There was a very limited field to choose from because there were very few good, plummy women's roles this year.
Taking advantage of the lack of competition, the distributors of Passion Fish and Love Field opened briefly in December so their actresses could qualify for the 92 Oscars. Ironically, the theme of this year's Academy Awards is Oscars celebrates women and the movies. At a recent Academy event honoring past female winners, the honorees weren't buying it.
This is the year of the missing woman.
I don't think there's any question that there are very few roles for women, and there haven't been for years.
Even those who try to break with tradition, like the screenwriter of Thelma and Louise, say it's an uphill battle.
Generally, women are in movies for one thing, and that's to provide the sex, or to provide the victim, or to provide the person who's going to die of a terminal illness.
In a year when more than a few good men have had so much work, the women of Hollywood are wondering when they will be offered more than a few good roles. Judy Muller, ABC News, Los Angeles.
Quickly, the weather. Snow squalls will make visibility near zero along the Great Lakes. The West Coast, another day of heavy rain. The Sierras and Northern Rockies get a foot or two of snow. Temperatures cold in the east, a little bit warmer in the middle of the country. World News Now, National Temperature Index, 427, a little warmer. The forecast and San Francisco.
Believe me, missy, when you're born to be a sissy without the feminine vibe. But I could show my prowess, be a lion, not a mouse, if I only had the nerve. I'm afraid there's no denying I'm just a dandelion, a fate I don't deserve. I'd be brave as a blizzard.
I'd be gentle as a lizard.
I'd be clever as a gizzard.
If the wizard is a wizard, who will serve?
Then I'm sure to get a brain,
a heart,
a home,
the knife.
World News Now weather brought to you by the Plus ATM Network.
You know you can get cash just across the street. But did you know you can get cash all across the country? Using the same card you use at the cash machines at home. That is, when your card has a Plus. Because Plus marks the spot for cash when you travel. At cash machines in big cities and small towns. In all 50 states and beyond. So check your card and name your street.
Want to know more about talking to your children about AIDS and AIDS prevention? Send for a free guide filled with valuable information prepared by the U.S. Centers for Disease Control. Call 1-800-342-AIDS.
The city of Berlin is making a strong bid to host the Summer Olympic Games in the year 2000, but now a group of militant Germans is opposing the idea because it's upset with the neo-Nazi resurgence in Germany these days. The group says it's produced a video that it will send to all the members of the International Olympic Committee to convince them not to award the Games to Berlin. The video includes film of Adolf Hitler attending the Berlin Olympics of 1936. Berlin's mayor says he thinks, though, the chances of the IOC giving the games to Berlin are improving. On the other side of the ledger, sport has often been seen as a way to bring people together. In our sports feature this half hour, ESPN's Roy Firestone talks with Jesse Jackson about sport as a racial unifier. We've added the scores.
When you walk into a Rose Bowl with 100,000 people and you see people pulling for people by uniform color, not just by skin color, for blacks and whites, flow smoothly. They didn't get that from watching the U.S. Senate.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't get that from watching the White House. They didn't get that from watching the ranks of college presidents. They got that basically through a process of being socialized, watching the athletic arena at its best. You see Jack Twyman and Maurice Stokes embracing.
Is that progress, though?
Indeed it is.
It is definitely.
At its best, it is Gale Sayers and Brian Piccolo. At its best, it's Divock and Magic embracing. And so athletics at its best can, in fact, make us better people and make a society better. I'll say to the athletes, use this power for something other than personal gratification. Use it for social transformation.
Doesn't sport reinvest in the stereotype?
Well, I think the point is that we must see sports as an industry, not just as a particular act. In other words, an $80 billion industry. Perhaps athletics and entertainment is to blacks what oil is to Arabs or what technology is to Japanese. The difference is the Japanese more or less control their technology.
Mm-hmm.
And the Arabs more or less control the oil from raw to finished product.
Robert Jesse Jackson, that's the sports for this half hour. Coming up, we'll bounce around Washington to get some analysis of the president's speech from our own correspondents. ABC's World News Now continues after this from our ABC stations.